A muckraker, that's the term President Teddy Roosevelt used for journalists back in his day. And in that tumultuous booming era at the turn of the 20th century, when the country was inundated with new technology and mass immigration, Washington gridlock and a cavernous gap between rich and poor. Sound familiar? Teddy Roosevelt called himself a progressive. So how much has really changed about the presidency, the country, and journalism over the past 100 years? And I'm joined now by Doris Kearns Goodwin, Pulitzer Prize winner and author of the new book, The Bully Pulpit, Theodore Roosevelt, William Howard Taft, and the Golden Age of Journalism. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm glad to be here.
Thanks for classing up the joint. So President Obama, a huge fan of your last book, Team of Rivals, obviously in the initial stages of his presidency. He had a lot of rivals, Joe Biden, Hillary Clinton. He tried to get a Republican senator, Judd Gregg, et cetera. What lessons can he take from this book, which is about how Teddy Roosevelt and William Howard Taft worked with journalists to create the progressive era?
I think the most important thing is that what the term bully pulpit means, you've got the platform to mobilize the country, to put pressure on a Congress. Does he ever need to put pressure on a Congress? But you have to have a good relationship with the press to do it. Teddy had the most remarkable relationship. He let them in when he was having his shaving hour, the barber's hour. The poor barber's trying to shave him while he's talking to the press. They could come in when he was signing papers at the end of the day. They had lunch, they had dinner, they had breakfast with him. He was friends with the press.
And he actually was the first one to give the White House press a room in the White House.
Right. He saw that they were just standing outside in the rain, so he thought it'd be nice to give them a press room inside.
Where does politicians and journalists uniting to get rid of injustice end, and a politician using reporters begin?
That's a really good question. I think what made it work for him was that he was a fellow writer, so he really respected journalists, and they respected him. They could criticize one another, though. They kept their integrity. They would write things mean about him or bad about him, not sensational things, but they could criticize his remedies. He could criticize them, and that's what made it work. For example, one journalist wrote to him one time about his Rough Rider memoir, and they said he was so egotistical, it was as if he put himself in the center of every action. It should have been called Alone in Cuba. Mm-hmm. He then writes to the journalist, "I regret to tell you my family loved your review of my book. Now you owe me. I want you to meet me." That's the attitude you have to have. It's a really thick skin.
A lot of conservatives probably think that President Obama has a bunch of reporters in his pocket already.
I don't think the country would feel that his way of dealing with the country has been eased by the press. I think the press is much more complicated today. I think ever since Watergate, there's been a more antagonistic view between presidents and press. It's good to have the tension, but I think you also need them as a channel. And if you can make your peace with the fact that you're not going to be happy with everything they write, you should have press conferences a couple times a week. That's what FDR did. Maybe you don't want to have them around all that time, and now they're into your private lives in the ways they weren't in this time. But I think in the end, in a democracy, you can't get by without the press.
It's not an uncritical portrait of Teddy Roosevelt, but you love him. You loved writing about him. You loved learning about him. You really have a great respect for him.
I'll tell you what, the only reason I choose the subject in the first place, I'm going to live with him for so long, 7 years with him, 10 years with Lincoln, 6 years with FDR. I have to like them at the beginning. I couldn't write about Hitler or Stalin. So I start out with affection and liking. Of course, they disappoint you. You get mad at them. You write critically about them. But in the end, I want to wake up with this guy every morning.
And one of the things that this book does that other scholars haven't focused on as much is how much William Howard Taft, even though they had this huge falling out, later on, how much Taft was an essential part of what Teddy Roosevelt was trying to do.
Absolutely. I mean, they were friends from the time they were in their early 30s. More than I knew, they'd exchanged 400 letters between themselves. Teddy would say about Taft, "my beloved friend." And more importantly, when he was in the White House with Teddy, he was acting president. Teddy would go off for weeks at a time on a bear hunt. Right. He'd go, it's incredible to imagine, right? Mm. He was on train trips going around the country, and Taft was running things, and he depended on him. And he also believed that government had a role to deal with the social and economic problems of the industrial age, which is what Teddy was standing for.
And yet, when Taft became president himself, he didn't really measure up.
He didn't know how to deal with the public. He really always wanted to be a judge, and luckily the last years of his life he becomes Supreme Court Chief Justice. So he thought when you're a judge, you don't have to explain things. You just make a decision and then the public will understand. He didn't like dealing with the press. He fell short, and also the rupture in the Republican Party. We think we've got a civil war now in the Republican Party. This was really deep between the progressives and that side of the conservatives, and it was too deep maybe for even Teddy to handle by the time Taft couldn't handle it.
Doris Kearns Goodwin, thank you so much.
You're so welcome.